and literary festival for having me here. Just a caveat before we begin the session. Both Maria and I are going to be in conversation, but we're also going to be talking about Maria's book and about the ways in which such writing interconnects, overlaps, reaches out and has a wider relevance generally to women's lives. Both our books are about our mothers primarily, but they're also about other women in our lives. They are about ourselves, and they are about the choices that we made in writing these books. And, you know, a lot of questions have been asked about why we wrote these books and what choices we made and what the response of family members was like. And there's a lot of history, culture, etc. that inevitably comes up. So I'm hoping that some of this will emerge during our discussion together today. And I'd just like briefly to tell you why I wrote the memoir. It really began when I began writing my other study of Indian womanhood called Caste as Woman. And though that book evolved out of my theoretical interest in various issues of feminism, writing it had a great deal to do with seeing my mother in the years after she was widowed. So in some ways, this book began at that time, but I couldn't use the material in Caste as Woman because that was a more academic exercise. I say in one of the concluding chapters that I see a parallel between the lives of my mother and grandmothers and my own troubled present. All of us have found ourselves standing at the threshold not only of modernity and tradition, both of which I see as evolving with each generation, and some of this was beautifully brought out by the discussants earlier, but of a nation's history. And, you know, this is in some ways how my memoir evolved. I'd like now to move on to Maria and have her talk to you a little bit about why she wrote the book. And, you know, don't worry, I'm not going to stand here and pontificate.
Before I say anything about myself, I'd like to thank the panelists of the earlier session, who are all uniformly brilliant. And so much of what they said resonates with what I have been trying to do in the two books that I've written, which are specifically about poor, which is to try to understand our unique culture. And I have tried to project the idea of the culture of humanism through both the books. In the first book, I did a trawl 450 years or 500 years of Goan history, and in my mind it was trying to show the changing culture of Goa, and I'm proud to say that it is the first book, as far as I know, and the only book that looks at both the communities together. When Penguin asked me to write about Goa, it was one of those miracles that happened to me, I was asked for a book. And I said, well, I'll write about Goa, but don't expect the kind of books you already have. It is going to be a book about Goikar, Goans. And for me, both the communities are one. I will not write about Catholic Goa. It's going to be an understanding of our culture where I take the whole community. And so it's perhaps one of the first books that looks at the conversion process in three chapters. To see the evolution of our society through those troubled times, in which both communities lived in peace. So that yesterday when I was at Mr. Gandhi's session and I was drawn into the discussion about, Maria, please explain how Goa has this, you know, inclusive culture. And I quoted poet Bhati Babolka, who spoke in terms of Vagrant Munshakon and unique humanism. and he traces it to, again, our history. Our history which went far, you know, beyond the Portuguese because of the fact that we are a coastal people, we've had interactions with so many cultures, so many religions, we had a very strong Buddhist influence, and we had a very strong Islamic influence, and of course there's the seedbed of Hinduism that's always sustained us. And then came Christianity, and the two merged. I do believe that we merged. So I'd like to thank all those who spoke earlier, because it makes it so much easier for me to explain what I'm trying to do. So if the first book was about, you know, the whole of Goa and how we all evolved as a society, and I must say it was taken in good spirits by people in Goa, but there are many who disagree, as they should. In the second book, I tried to do the same with the story of my mother. Although I thought of it as a tribute to my mother, and it is a tribute to my mother, it is also a way of trying to understand the decadence of our society, predominantly Goan Catholic society at that time, between the First World War and liberation. So I look at both, you know. And for my mother, and I was looking at the time of both the books, when I felt that the space was shrinking, the cultural space. I mean, we've heard about this, so many of you have spoken about this, and for me, it's a terrifying scene, because I've grown up in a society where there was a sort of unlimited space for multiple identities. And my mother left Goa with three little children, the youngest being 3 years old, and a problematic husband. She had grown up and lived and got married and raised these three children in a society where she only spoke Konkani and Portuguese. She barely heard English. And she made a life for herself and for her 7 children, and here I am. Going into a society where she had never heard Kannada, she had never heard Marathi, she had barely heard English. She was surrounded by neighbors and everything which went completely contrary to everything that she had known. And she was completely accepted. And I often talk about this, you know, to my friends in Dharwa. What sort of society did we live in? It was magical. And I don't think it was specific to Dharwa. So I hope that's enough about it. We decided to have to do without an in-between person to keep us talking, because we are both teachers of English literature, and I'm quite used to it.
Well, many of the things that Maria said resonate with me also. My grandmother had to make certain choices. My grandmother was widowed in the First War. And I'd just like to read out a passage to give you an idea of why she made some of the choices, and, you know, then go on to talk a little bit about, you know, the way they impacted my mother and my mama. Now, after she was widowed, she made the decision which was unusual at that time. Remember that this was in the 1919s or 1920s or whatever. And she decided she wasn't going to return to Mundkur, which was her family home, but stay on in what was then Bombay. And she faced opposition, and there were pressures on her to return, but she was adamant that she wasn't going to. And speaking of cultural history and so on, I mean, as an academic, as a feminist, I've studied various aspects of women's issues, but then suddenly these little cultural footnotes crop up in your day-to-day interactions. And this is a cultural perception of widowhood, which comes to me straight from my mother, describing her mother and her grandmother. What would the return to the home in the village have meant? Ai tells me again and again of watching Sundiamma weep, her hair loose and disheveled, as she resisted her own mother's pressure to have her head tonsured. A 5-year-old watching her mother and her mother's mother locked in battle between two worlds of thought. Sunyama fighting to preserve her dead husband's legacy of progressive liberalism, the stranglehold of orthodoxy and conservatism in which her mother was trapped. No, Sundiyamma says over and over again to her mother, he would not have wanted it. And finally, screaming out loud, not in front of the child, this is a translation from the Kokani, so it may sound a little awkward. Don't bring this up in front of the child. I want to look normal, live a normal life, for my children's sake, not mine. Is it fair that they've lost their father? Don't make them lose their mother too. I listening, wondering, why doesn't Papa come home? Why shouldn't I mention him? Because this was one of the first taboos. For some odd reason, my mother's uncles insisted that my grandfather not be mentioned. And he was never talked about. There was a kind of mysterious silence surrounding him, which was very strange, and it also brought no closure to his widow and children because his body was never recovered. And, you know, it impacted my mother in various ways, and it all came to the forefront much later when she had her breakdown in 1961. And we realized just how much the grandfather had worked as a form of emotional blackmail on her. Blackmail by her uncles, blackmail by her, you know, mother. And she was even pressured into going in to do medicine, though she wanted to do literature. Because her father had been a doctor in the Indian Medical Services and was deputed to the Navy when the war broke out. And she was unable for various reasons, you know, social more than anything else, to pursue the profession with the dedication it deserved. And this troubled her, and it was one of the reasons primarily, I think, among other things, that led to the breakdown. So it was a classic example of the personal and the public, the personal and the professional, which also made me interested in writing about these things and writing, you know, about women's lives in general. But Maria, going on to, you know, your book, my book, there is the aspect of memory and there's the aspect of memoir. So would you like to say something about the way in which when memory becomes memoir, it gets transformed?
Yes, before I say anything about memory and memoir, I thought I'd add something to what you said. And that is the terrible constraints under which...
Speak in the mic.
Constraints, is that better? Constraints that were experienced by your widowed grandmother. I've told you earlier that your widowed grandmother has a pattern in my mother who was widowed at the age of 42 and before that was more or less functioning as a single parent. And that brings me back to the earlier pattern where I think it was Tim Krishna who said that can you talk about culture without talking about religion and caste. And I see the huge difference between my mother and your grandmother, where my mother had immense family support and certainly none of the restrictions that may come with widowhood which are imposed by religion. And I have taught in Delhi for many years, and a lot of my students who read this book said to me that the kind of family support your mother had, and the interesting thing is that my mother had support from both sides of the family, my father's side as well as her own side, is almost impossible to envision, and I'm really troubled by that. And these are modern girls talking to me. This kind of support would never come in our lives. Of course, they were not talking personally, but they were talking about societies in general, belonging they belong to different states. And for me, that came as a huge surprise. I mean, it saddened me. So I was taken aback when I read your book and what your grants. But my mother had a difficult life, but she had immense support from the family on both sides. So to get back to what you said, caste and religion are important. Memoir and memory. Well, many people ask me, is this a memoir? And I was interested yesterday when I was talking to Frederick Corona, who has a publishing concern here, that he finds it easier to sell memoirs than fiction. I thought that was amazing. He says, you know, people are quite happy to buy memoirs, but, you know, fiction goes slowly. I must confess that my book is a lot of memory, and I have had to invent my children, my parents' childhood. So there's fiction. There's fiction in it, because I did not know the details of their childhood. I knew the dramatic details, which you will find if you read the book. But a lot of the daily life and what happened in the bit. My father was came from the elegant part, most elegant part of Goa at that time, which was Margao. And he belonged to a very posh family. My mother came from a village and led a much simpler life. But since I am poor, I have, thank goodness, although I grew up in Dabar, my parents raised us in a predominantly Goan cultural home. I have complete access to both languages, and I have been in and out of Goa for many years, and now I've lived in Goa for the last 14 years. So researching and imagining has been part of this book. So I can't say it's memory. You know, it's reliving that sort of life. But yes, to get back to caste, I have not been able to escape. I was talking to Vrinda about the difference between the way this book of mine has been reviewed. It was very widely reviewed in the national press, and it was also reviewed a bit in Goa. And there's a big difference between the two, because in Goa, one is inevitably trapped in caste. It's an elite society. It is a caste-based, it's a Brahmin world, etc., etc. And the real story, which is to do with the culture of humanism, irrespective of caste. And because the fact that there was a humane aspect of my mother's life, happened to be a Brahmin, but got on extremely well with the tenants who looked after the fields. So well that they still keep in touch with me, they come and visit me in my village. It's most embarrassing because I don't own any land except my garden. But that is lost on the Goan review. And for me, it is sad, because I feel we are shrinking. If we keep on looking at these differences, this culture of humanism will never come. I'm not at all denying caste. I'm not at all. There are terrible things that happen in Goa in the name of caste, and it's shaming. But if we have to dwell on, I think, a larger picture as well.
I'd like to go back a little bit to, you know, this memory memoir thing. I share with you the idea that a lot of it becomes fiction inevitably, because one is entering into other worlds. And I can again refer to an anecdote which I heard about as a child. Now, my mother and grandmother, in their own little way, became involved in, you know, the freedom movement the way every Indian at that time was. And one of my favorite childhood stories had been this, you know, hearing about Mahatma Gandhi setting off with his supporters and followers to the west coast of India to, you know, start what became the Dandi Salt March. And this had triggered off various rebellions throughout India, but the one that interested me was the one that took place on Chowpatty Beach in Bombay. And what was interesting about this, what was unique about this, was that it was a ceremony performed by women, of women, and for women. So, Navwari saris, you know, the nine-yard saris women in my region wear, flapped in the sea breeze that morning to the refrain of Mithata Kaida Modla, Mithata Kaida Modla, we've broken the salt law. As these assembled women from the Saraswat Mahila Samaj gathered seawater in little glass bottles and went home to distill it and make salt. Now, in the vanguard of these rebels was my grandmother, who was widowed, and my mother, who was by then a teenager. So as a child, I heard this story in different versions from different people, and my mind would be fired with images of a group of brave women fighting with Gandhi to end foreign oppression. And it was only later, as I grew up and began to hear stories, began to look around me, that I became aware of the many native strictures that had constrained these women in their individual lives. And as my mother talked, I realized that there was material here. This was a woman who had trained to be a doctor, who had gone to Edinburgh in the 1930s to study for the FRCS, and who had come back when the Second War broke out because her mother couldn't stand the thought of losing a child to a war after having lost her husband. And today it seems to me that in today's world this might be unthinkable given the size of our diasporas and the reality of the Indian diaspora. There may be people who still pressure children, but I can't see that happening today. I know that the reality of the diaspora has been accepted by us. But my mother agreed to write her life but died before we could start the project. And I eventually discovered so many letters, jottings, photographs, and above all a journal that she kept from 1930 to 1939 when her relationship with my father was evolving. And there it was a remarkable record of history and the individual, because she was writing during one of the most tumultuous times in Indian and in global history. She was in Edinburgh when the Second War broke out and left and landed in Italy the day Italy joined the war, and she was marooned there without any money for about 9 days. So, you know, all these things, finding out about all these things, took my writing, I have to confess, to another level. Before that, it had been colorless. It had been memory largely, though I have a wild imagination and I did try to imbue it with some more flesh and blood. But I found that this enabled me also to contextualize the whole thing, and it made the process of the memoir writing easier in a sense, because it wasn't just a family story of my mother and my grandmother and you know, all of us. It became something more. It became the lives of so many other people who are mentioned in the journal. It became a life of relationships. It became a life of mothers and daughters, because there's so much in the journal which talks about the tensions between mother and daughter. And that is something which in those days would have been more or less unuttered. So I found this interesting, because today a lot is written about mothers and daughters, and daughters have written about mothers, and there's a whole lot of ambivalence that goes on there. But one never talked about these things, one never admitted them. One saw sublimation of motherhood as, you know, something that was, you know, there, it was a given. And what I find in both our books is that your mother, my grandmother, they had a kind of ability, you know, they both made journeys. They both did what they did for the sake of their children. And they stuck on against certain odds. And they had strengths of a very different different kind. Strengths that perhaps having grown up and, you know, grown into another world, we sometimes take for granted.
We not only take them for granted, I don't think we have them. I certainly don't have my mother's strength. We are five daughters, and five of us get together and say, all five of us together do not have the strength. One of the things we both talked about, but I just mentioned it now, in passing, is that we were dealing with a society affected by different colonialisms. You know, my mother was inside a Portuguese colonial world in Goa, and then when she moved to Dharwa, it was still British India. Vrinda's family was not only part of India, but very closely involved in the independence movement. So that was an interesting talking point for us. But what I found, speaking about discovering my mother through the writing, what I found at the end of my book, or while writing my book, is how much my mother had grown, you know, through her own struggle. She must have left the, you know, the familiar world of Goa for this totally unfamiliar world of Dharwa, with much reputation but great faith. And at the end of, 37 years, I think it was, when all of us were married and we didn't want her to be alone in Dharwa because we were not close enough to look after her, and said she should move back to Goa, and we decided that we would buy her a flat there. She refused to go back. She said, I can't go back to that world anymore. So she had grown inside a world of, you know, even more multiple identities than she had experienced in the confines of, you know, the upper class Portuguese Goan world. The other thing that I discovered was her own attitude to my life. After I got married, Goa was liberated, and my husband was posted here as a civil servant from the Indian government. And I had a 6-month-old baby, and there was no higher education here, and the first colleges were started, and there, believe it or not, there was nobody to teach English literature. There was Professor Lucio Rodrigues, who was a very, very, very well-known professor from Bombay, had then become a freedom fighter and come to Goa. He was there, and then they actually came to ask me to teach, yeah, because without you, we can't start, you know, teaching papers in English. And my mother was very upset. She said, please don't go and teach. You've been struggling all your life. You've worked so hard. It's the first time you have some time to relax, and you have a husband who can support you. And she didn't want me to teach. But of course I went. And many, many years later, maybe 15 years later, when I was doing my PhD, she used to write to my children, please give your mother some peace. She has to finish her PhD. So you see, she had grown in these ways, grown in her relationship to what she expected or was ambitious for her daughters, and grown in herself in what she wanted for her future life and her aging. And eventually she died in Bombay in the house of one of my sisters. So she never really went back to live in Goa because she had grown out of that, because it was an extremely conservative society in which she had lived and grown up. But she was a free spirit, and she grew beyond that, and through her struggle she grew even further. And I think that was a discovery I made through the writing of the book. I think that we've said enough. I'd love responses from you, especially those that have read the book. Any questions? Yeah. Come on, Alice, you're there. Ready to ask me?
So I'd like to thank you for writing about your mothers, because I think just as I listen to you, I feel like that I've written about my own mother, and I'm quite sure all of us get this feeling right now. whether we were close to our mothers or not, but just writing about mothers who eventually turn out very special, because we, girls grow into mothers eventually, whether you marry or not, you just have that, the desire maybe to be a mother or to do something that is motherly. I'd like to write, I feel inspired to write about my own mother. Each one has this interesting thing to write about. Maybe we don't have the style or the ability to express ourselves. But what you said earlier, Mrs. Couto said earlier about the younger women today. Being a teacher, I get in touch with a lot of young girls today who have various issues of relationships. And quite often they are relationships which maybe are strained relationships with others. I wonder whether it's a kind of paradox of 21st century, where we want our daughters to be independent. We want them to break that bond. And they are moving away from their mothers. They're losing a lot of what they could have learned maybe culturally or traditionally from their mothers, or gained from the strength of their mothers. Is that a paradox you came across in your own life? Did you find the need to move away from your mother, yet you also wanted to kind of stay with them, or they wanted you to stay with them?
No, I don't think I have the need to move away from my mother, because you see, I am the eldest of 7 children, and because of a troubled family life, I became an adult very young. So I sometimes, when I look back, I sometimes feel that I looked at my mother like as if she was my daughter. It's a different situation altogether from the one that I would have with my daughter, for instance. So I felt protective towards my mother. So there was no question of moving away, because I felt responsible for her well-being. Whereas the relationship that I have with my daughter would certainly be very different, and I know that we have conflicts, and I know that she doesn't agree with a lot that I say. And that's true. What you're saying is quite right, that modernity and the desire of the whole notion of being independent has created some problems. But I think daughters should talk about what they feel. The young, I can't speak about it, because I'm not just an old mother, but a grandmother.
I'd just like to add to that. I thought that was an interesting question and a very relevant one, because I did mention the relationship between mothers and daughters, and the ways in which it's expressed these days, which for the longest time it wasn't. And I remember being absolutely stunned when I read Simone de Beauvoir many, many years ago, because I thought the kind of things she talked about, I was much younger then, I was about 16, I think. And I thought, oh my God, how can you talk about your mother that way? But I see that it's also, a very fundamental aspect of mothers and daughters. And I talk a lot about that in the book, actually, because being widowed, my grandmother was a strong woman, but the pressures on her were such that she often had to lean on the person she was closest to, which was my mother, who was not much younger, And it put a lot of pressures on my mother as a little girl. And it expressed itself in various ways when both of them were adults. So one saw the mother-daughter ambivalence as one was growing up. And, I think we all go through that. And I think one of the things that writing today has made available to us is this disconnect between ideal mothering and actual mothering. Between ideal daughterhood and actual daughterhood. So go and write your book.
There's time for a couple of questions.
I'd like to begin by thanking you for the sensitive and brave kind of writing of personal history. I just began reading, if I may say, Maria. I just began reading Maria's book. Can you hear me in the back? There are two questions which I'd like to ask. One is from memory to memoir. What I'd like to know is how close to truth is memory in your writings, and how much does it get colored by love along the way? And so, if you as a writer or anyone else really take on truth vis-a-vis the wishes and sensitivities of the rest of the family is involved, because you're just not writing just about yourself. There are many other siblings, relatives along the way.
Difficult questions.
The first one about memory is well known to be unreliable. So I can say that I've done my best, but whether I've got it right, I can't say. Yes. Because it is not something that I have researched, you know, and I haven't talked, my mother never talked, so I don't have the voice except through memory or through imagination. About family sensitivities, yes, it was a troubling question, and it was more or less resolved. But apart from family sensitivities, I was also concerned about the reaction of our very conservative society. I could almost hear voices resound around me of disapproval, and I'm sure there has been disapproval, there's no question about that. But either you do it, or you don't. And I had decided that I was going to do this tribute to my mother and also look at our society. And we are a very close family, and I think we more or less resolved our issues.
Did you try? Did you actually write what you felt and believed in?
Yes, I wrote what I felt and believed in. I did not censor myself at all. I have been more gentle in some respects. Especially in dealing with my father, whom I admired and loved very much. But even so, in spite of the gentleness with which I have treated various troubling issues, I'm sure within society, not within my family, but within society, I'm sure there is a problem. We do have a culture of secrecy. There's no question about it. It's not just within Goa, but it's predominant everywhere.
Yes, it was difficult. It was one of the most difficult. I think eventually one does what one has to. And I tried as far as possible to be sensitive to the various things. I couldn't always be sensitive about that. I may have offended some people, but I think the person I feel bad about is in the process of not offending others. I may have been unfair to my mother.